Good evening. It's hard to believe that we would already be halfway through our festival had Mostly Mozart gone according to plan this year. Yes, our halls may be dark, but the heart of Lincoln Center is still beating. And artists everywhere have taken the challenge to find new ways to bring music to our community, whether through outdoor recording sessions, Zoom lessons, or virtual concertizing. Indeed, music lives on. Tonight, we will reprise the Mostly Mozart Festival 50th anniversary celebration, broadcast live from Lincoln Center. This performance included Mozart's symphonic Alpha and Omega, his very first symphony composed at age 8, and his glorious and jubilatory Jupiter Symphony, composed 24 years later, along with Richard Goode's masterful interpretation of Mozart's 12th piano concerto. At intermission, we'll take a look back at the 50 years of Mostly Mozart and hear from some of the outstanding artists that regularly contribute to this great festival. It is my pleasure to be able to introduce this evening's performance from here on the beautiful Lincoln Center campus. And I look forward to when you are back here with us for the return of Lincoln Center's Mostly Mozart Festival. Enjoy this evening.
Live from Lincoln Center is made possible by the Robert Wood Johnson 1962 Charitable Trust, dedicated to enriching the lives of all Americans through medical research, education, and the arts. Thomas H. Lee and Ann Tenenbaum. The Robert and Renee Belfer Family Foundation, Mercedes T. Bass, and the National Endowment for the Arts. Funding for this episode is provided by Rita E. and Gustav M. Hauser.
Thank you. Thank you. Good evening, and welcome to the opening program of the Mostly Mozart Festival.
This festival combines the informality that comes with the summer season and, of course, the tradition of superb music making.
Yeah, there's a real summer festival style to this annual New York love affair with Mozart.
Because the concert is about to begin.
The first year of the festival would have been 66. I had just become a student at Juilliard. For us, it was very special. I was a New Yorker.
You would go to the New York Yankees or the New York Mets. You would go to Shakespeare in the Park, and you would go to Mostly Mozart. It became a kind of summertime institution.
It's quite astonishing when you look at the history of the festival and what has changed, evolved, and what is still here.
It's amazing to feel the whole festival be revitalized and to feel so alive and vibrant. So the season is the 50th anniversary season, and we wanted to celebrate the extraordinary achievement of 50 years of Mostly Mozart.
It is mostly Mozart. It is not only Mozart, but Mozart is in the center of the inspiration of the festival.
And Mozart did lots of things. He did religious music, he did opera, he did piano music and concertos, and anything that took his fancy. That's what's so amazing about having a Mostly Mozart festival, because the key to that door, frankly, allows you to do almost anything.
He wrote a lot of music. There's nothing new. You know, he's been dead for a long time. So it's not just to rehash and recatalog, but to reapproach and rethink.
I love Mozart beyond everything in the world, but music has got to keep on reinventing itself.
You know, I think I will say it in Mozart's words himself. He said, "All I insist on is that you should show the world that you're not afraid."
This year, we have brought back Mozart dances by the amazing choreographer and musician also, Marc Maurice.
First of all, the whole idea of celebrating Mozart by creating dances around piano concertos, I think, was totally inspired. For example, if you were doing the second movement of the F major concerto in a concert, it would probably be much, much quicker than we wound up doing. But this is the vision Mark had. And when you see it and hear it, it's perfect.
When I was young, to me, Mozart's music seemed like obvious and simple and sort of la-di-da. And then as I grew up, my ear changed and I thought, how did I miss that? How did I not notice that Mozart was such a great human being, and the music is so, well, attractive.
Mozart dances was definitely a highlight of my life, I would say. This year I get to participate by playing with the Emerson Quartet, and we're doing the Dvorak Quintet in one concert, and then we're doing a late night, which I'm thrilled about because I love doing the late night concerts.
One great pride and joy of this festival. We have now this wonderful series of concerts called Little Night Music. It is so close to Mozart's spirit because we have, of course, the official concert at David Geffen Hall. And then after, we have one late night concert in the very intimate space, like Mozart would do himself. I mean, after an important concert, they went to some cafe and they continued the evening.
In Mozart's time, people only wanted to hear contemporary music and music written for them. So when Mozart was traveling and arriving in the city, the advertisement was a new symphony or a new concerto.
In his time, the music of Mozart was contemporary music. And we wanted to continue that tradition, that there would be music in the festival that was contemporary the way Mozart was contemporary.
ICE is a Brooklyn-based collective of musicians, curators, arts advocates, composers, improvisers. It's kind of like a 21st century new music circus. I think it was Jane who said, so you know, we've got this anniversary coming up. This is a pretty significant thing. What could ICE do to amplify the celebration around this milestone, 50 years? And I said, simple, 50 premieres.
They're doing 50 premieres for the 50 years of Mostly Mozart, many of which will be done outside and will be for free.
We think of creating these new pieces as a deeply collaborative endeavor. We're building a new language. We're building new instruments. We're learning how to play those instruments. We're learning how to shape this new language with these new tools. All of it's new, all of it's vulnerable, all of it is terrifying. But as Mozart reminds us, our duty is to show the world that we're not afraid. And so we work through that fear by helping each other through that process and creating something that's new and unfamiliar and exciting to all of us.
Mozart was in many respects a populist. So if you think about his operas, they were an attempt to show the lives of real people. They were ordinary people doing ordinary things with ordinary problems. And this was, for his day, really revolutionary.
He was thinking very deeply about religion and ethics and morals and humanity and our foibles and our frailties. Mozart was working at a time where these things that had always been accepted as coming down from a higher power and unquestionable were being questioned. So for the first time, people were questioning privilege, prejudice, class relations and gender relations, which for me, particularly in the times that we live in, this is a rich scene and is something that actually I feel that we need more of. In Mozart's time, people would talk all the time about what it meant to be human. And I think that's something that everybody can benefit from.
We also commissioned a work by David Lang, who is a Pulitzer Prize-winning composer. And he wrote a new work for us for 1,000 amateur singers, called Public Domain.
There were very powerful moments when we were walking around and you just hear everybody saying our civil liberties and our music, and one just gets a sense of community.
It was cool because it's just the sheer greatness of it. There's so many people and they're all like doing the same thing and then sometimes different things.
It was incredibly interesting to hear the different groups come in to understand that we're just one very small part of this whole piece that's being put together.
A lot of things we have in our society are things that actually put us into little groups. You know, our religions separate us, our politics separate us, our education separates us, our race separates us, our wealth or lack of separates us. So what is it that we share? The idea of the public domain is trying to find something optimistic and beautiful and common. And what I'm hoping will come out of that then is the people who experience it will feel that the world is full of lots of great things which are waiting to be discovered and waiting to happen.
The music is important, but the community spirit that creates is even more important. It really can change people's lives, I think. And this seems especially important in this very fractious country that we're currently living in.
Isn't it amazing to have this composer born 260 years ago and still speaking to us? And of course, the language is not modern, but the message of the music still touches us and elevates us. Probably more than ever, we need Mozart's music.
Thank you. Thank you. Watch the complete performances featured in this program at pbs.org. Find us on Facebook and join the conversation on Twitter using hashtag LFLC.
Live from Lincoln Center is made possible by the Robert Wood Johnson 1962 Charitable Trust, dedicated to enriching the lives of all Americans through medical research, education, and the arts. Thomas H. Lee and Ann Tenenbaum. The Robert and Renee Belfer Family Foundation, Mercedes T. Bass, and the National Endowment for the Arts. Funding for this episode is provided by Rita E. and Gustav M. Hauser.